Alrighty, welcome to another edition of Canon Calls. This week, I got the opportunity to chat with Colin Kaplan. Colin is a historian from New Haven, Connecticut, and a professor at Wesleyan College. In particular, what struck my interest was a book I stumbled across titled Pizza in New Haven. The pizza in New Haven has a rich history with a cast of great characters, and Colin captures it all really well. Be on the lookout for a documentary that Colin produced titled Pizza, A Love Story. You can catch that trailer on YouTube and the other usual places. So, without further ado, meet the pizza scribe of New Haven, Connecticut, Colin Kaplan. All right, welcome to another week of Canon Calls. This week, Colin Kaplan. Is that right, Kaplan?
Yes, sir.
Nailed it.
Yes, thank you for having me, Jake.
Nailed it. Yes, so I stumbled into Colin's book, Pizza in New Haven, and I'm on a pizza dive right now. I'm just like buying books, figuring out what's unique about here and there. Colin, what about Pizza in New Haven deserved a book?
Oh, man. Well, basically, pizza is New Haven's answer to everything. If you've got a problem, you eat pizza. If you feel really good about something, you go and you celebrate and you eat pizza. If it's a birthday, it's pizza. If it's a funeral, you got to eat pizza. So it's kind of like it's the only thing we care about. Let's just put it that way. We there's problems in the world, but our pizza never is a problem.
Okay, and we're talking about New Haven, Connecticut.
Correct. So most people have no idea where Connecticut is. It's the fourth or something smallest state, and then let alone where is New Haven. So we're kind of like New York City's little brother, and most people just don't even know we exist. So we're the underdog pizza capital of the United States. We're this kind of up and coming name that people are now starting to associate with some of the best pizza they'll ever eat.
I love that. You said you're the underdog pizza capital of the world. Would you naturally give that
yes.
to New York?
So, growing up here, we always thought New York was the center of the world. It's a bigger city. and in a sense, it's always been known for pizza. So if you go anywhere in the U.S., generally speaking, you might find a New York City style pizza place. It serves probably something close to what people think is New York style, which is like a floppy, cheesy, greasy slice. And that's what I think a lot of the country has accepted as what pizza can be or should be. So we grew up in New Haven with something that is a little bit different. It's thin, it's crispy, and it's really well cooked. So we call it charred, and it tastes like nothing you can find in New York. So, even though New York is so well known, New Haven, us New Haveners and people who've traveled here or schooled here or have heard of us, we are truly seen as a higher quality of pizza in general.
Is this the greatest U.S. rivalry in pizza?
I don't know. You know, that's a good question. I think Chicago and New York are huge rivals, because there's the Chicago style that people are familiar with in that area of the country is the deep dish. It's more of a casserole, but you can call it a pizza if you'd like.
It's like a lasagna with crust.
And yeah, I just think I don't have an hour to wait for my pizza either, like if it's being cooked. So there's that. But then again, a lot of the country is also familiar with this thicker crust stuff that we are now, the new Detroit kind of wave is taking over the country, and everyone wants to try this Detroit style. And what that basically is like is a Sicilian style of focaccia.
Okay.
And even New Yorkers have that style. So there's actually many different styles among the cities, and most people don't realize that's a truth, is that you can't say, oh, New York style is better. Well, there's many New York styles, and the New Haven has its own style. It's very particular to our city. It's something you could find all around the country now. There's New Haven style pizzerias in over 50 cities, and from every coast. So if you name a city, I'll tell you yes or no.
Wow.
And then you can figure out if you're going to live there or not.
Okay, so I'm in the Chimney of Idaho. What's the closest New Haven slice I can get?
Oh, the Chimney. Well, since everything is fairly close there, you guys have small states,
yeah,
very
right.
small, you know, runways, whatever. Well, there's not much actually up there, I'm sorry to say.
Okay.
The closest was in Reno. But now I would say the closest would be either Portland, Oregon.
Oh, that's not bad.
Hood River, Oregon, or even Seattle. You could find like something close to a New Haven style. So those are your sort of closest runs.
Okay. That's easy.
Yeah, just over the hill.
So with the book, Pizza in New Haven, it's very historical. You start out basically with the receipts on the pizza in New Haven. You start in Italy, at least with Italian settlement.
Yes. So I am a historian. And I document a lot of different types of history. I've written multiple books about New Haven, my favorite city. And the stories are very fascinating because if we look at a little bit of our understanding of how different parts of our country were formed, you got to look at people. And the people I focused on for pizza in New Haven were the Italians. And so our city, New Haven, became the most Italian city per capita in America by 1910. And so its story, and if you look at New Haven even today in Greater New Haven, it's such an Italian place. And people don't even question why or how. So I tried to, with this book, tell a story about an American story about Italians and how they settled here for the need for jobs, surviving a place that wasn't working for their families and coming to a place that offered more, and then bringing their culture with them, something that we would be shocked to know that over 100 years ago, Italian culture was considered second rate. People looked down on Italians. People wouldn't even touch pizza, let alone like lasagna or, you know, some sort of other type of dish that we now love. So Italians were really outsiders coming in to a new place, and they had to carve their way into this cultural landscape and actually created an American cultural landscape that's partly Italian, because pizza is very much American now.
Right. And even the idea of Italian food, yeah. You mentioned, what a rocky story, you know, to go from like what was seen as second rate to, I feel like that's probably your baseline idea of date food or.
Yeah. You know? I mean, it's comfort food. It's kind of like everywhere you go, you can find an Italian restaurant now, whether it's good or bad, you know, in America. And it's part of our cultural landscape. And it's really a testament to how this country is a melting pot and has always been since its founding. So it's the idea of a mixed bag of you get who came here. And we are very, very fortunate that the Italians mostly came from the South, where the food is exquisite there. And they brought all their red sauces and they brought their abits. We call pizza abits, by the way.
Oh, right, right.
It's an ancient, what the language was called, Neapolitan or Napolitan. It's an ancient language that stayed in New Haven.
Wow.
And nowhere else do they really even speak it besides maybe families in Italy, you know, that are still using it. But that's where this word abits, which is spelled APIZZA, so it looks like a pizza,
right?
And that's our word. I mean, that's how we make it.
Now, can you give us just a few of maybe? And you mentioned just the important aspect of the pizza is going to be the pizza makers, to the people doing it. What are some of your favorite stories in terms of heroes of New Haven pizza?
Well, I think the biggest, you know, hero that everyone is beginning to learn about more and more is Frank Pepe, because his family still runs a pizzeria that is presently the fifth longest continuously run pizzeria in America. So with that legacy, you know, if you look at his story, an immigrant from Maiori on the Amalfi Coast coming to America in 1909, working in a factory, and eventually opening his own bakery in 1925, which was a pizza delivery And he just served Italians who were working in factories, working in the streets, and helping them, you know, get a warm meal in their belly. And little did he or his wife know that, you know, 10, 15 years later, they'd end up with the largest pizzeria in the country. They'd open the doors to not just Italians eating pizza. And his style, like his method of pizza making, has been rated the number one pizza in America for the last 10 years and longer than that. So, you know, Frank Pepe's name is now synonymous with American pizza. And that's a fact.
I love it, dude.
At least I can say that. Yeah.
No, we'll leave it there, man. I love it. Okay, so as far as the pizzerias in town, what are the big ones? Like if you were to sort of paint a landscape for somebody that wanted to visit, what are the pizzerias you have to stop by?
I like the way you use that. I would actually go with that and paint a picture using pizza sauce.
Yes, I like that.
Yep, little oregano on the sides. So there is a movie that I've helped out with. I'm a co-producer on a movie called Pizza.
Oh man, I've been wanting to ask about this. I have been Googling to the dregs. Where do I watch it, man?
Yeah, exactly. So here's where you can watch it if you're in New Haven for the next week. It's at Bowtie Criterion Cinema, downtown New Haven, for the next week until the end of the month. And it's screening there on two theaters. That's how popular it's been. But this theater, this movie, directed by Connecticut director and you know, rock and pet loving director Gorman Bouchard, and co-produced by myself and Dean Falcone, who did all the music. This film has been screening all around the world, actually, at festivals. So the next step is that it could go to one of those. It's going to go to DVD later this year, and then it can go to like Hulu or something, hopefully. So, you know, keep crossing your fingers. We just tell people, you know, whatever they can do to try to get it or put a note out there or send a message to Gorman. That's kind of what we can do to get this message out. We want it to be in theaters everywhere. We want it to be at everyone's home. We think it should be playing on a loop at every train station. Anyway.
I kind of cut you off. What was the title and what's it about?
Yeah, it's called Pizza, A Love Story. And it is the story of the three pizzerias that matter most in the entire world. And that is Frank Pepe's, Sally's Abitz, and Modern Abitz. And all three of these pizzerias are some of the oldest in the country. They're considered some of the best in the country, and they all serve New Haven style pizza to the T. And they're known for different things. Pepe's is known for their white clam. Modern is known for their Italian bomb, which is like very healthy pizza of four meats and three vegetables, or three vegetables and four meats, something like that. And then Sally's is known for their plain tomato pie, which is just sauce and grated cheese with garlic on it. And, you know, Sally was Frank Pepe's nephew. Modern has been owned by a number of families, but it's been run by the same family for over 30 years. And these pizzerias are pinnacle pizzerias. I mean, Frank Sinatra loved Sally's. He used to order it to New York City at his shows in the 40s.
Oh, wow.
Very good friends with their family. Every politician has made it to Pepe's, from Reagan to Clinton to so many others. I mean, they make regular visits there. Steven Spielberg loves his Modern so much he brought it to L.A. to show off all of the Hollywood producers what real pizza is. And there's a great story in the movie as well about how somebody switched their allegiances. It was actually the owners of the Red Sox. The Boston Red Sox switched allegiances from being Sally's fans to Modern fans
one day.
And that year was the year that the curse of the Bambino was broken.
Oh, wow.
So they think that. So New Haven pizza is much more important of a deciding factor in so many things.
National implications.
National, international, possibly universal.
So
this could be cosmic.
So, okay, as a New Haven guy yourself, where is the go-to for you? How do you choose?
Well, Sure. So I choose, I mean, I run food tours in New Haven, so luckily I don't have to always choose. I can go to my favorite, you know, the best places because I'm leading people there. And we do regular food tours through Taste of New Haven weekly and bring people to the best pizzerias and some of the best restaurants as well. So if I'm choosing, it's kind of time of day, it's who's coming. It's also a mood thing. So often, you know, they're all open for lunch now. Most of them are open every day. Some of them close on a Monday. And, you know, if I feel like I want to go and have a really good mozzarella pie with, that's just going to make me satisfied with the mozzarella flavor, then I'm going to hit up Modern Abitz and get there for lunch perhaps and put some eggplant on that pie. Cause a little breaded eggplant right on with the mozzarella. It's like having a delicious meal on a thin crust.
Right.
If I wanted to show off New Haven's white clam pizza, which is just clams, oregano, garlic, and a little olive oil, and it's so simple. There's no mozzarella on it. It's a white pizza, so it's just olive oil. Then I would take them to Pepe's, and you're getting freshly shucked clams that are local. And people literally drive for hours to get that pizza, and then if I want, you know, I've always said this is my last meal.
Oh, here we go.
I would be very happy with a Sally's plain tomato pie with garlic on it. And there's no mozzarella. It's just a red pie. And it's the perfect balance of crispy, chewy crust, just slightly tangy, slightly sweet sauce with that wonderful flavor of garlic, you know, because that's all you need. I mean, that's really all it is. And that's what pizza's about. It's a simple product. It's to be easily enjoyed and easily eaten. And I dream about it too. So we're in the same boat.
You mentioned the clam pie. That seems like a very big deal. They're known for it. The kind of narrative you get about pizza is it started with, you know, as plain as it gets. And then now we're in a world where there's like tacos on top of pies and all this crazy stuff on top of pizzas. I feel like the clam is out of nowhere. Do you know, how did that start? How did that idea even come about?
Sure. So, you know, New Haven's on the coast. Connecticut sits on Long Island Sound. So we've had, since the ancient days, the Native Americans who lived here were harvesting oysters and all types of mollusks for thousands of years. So we've had a history of eating shellfish in this state for a long, long time.
Okay.
And when the Italians came here, they also came from coastal areas, and they found out that there was lots of shellfish here. So they started selling clams on the half shell in the streets, very common in America over 100 years ago. And, you know, you just kind of drink out of the clam shell. And so that ended up in the restaurants, and every pizzeria that became popular in the 1930s had clams on the half shell as an appetizer.
Okay.
So pizzerias like Frank Pepe's started experimenting. They started putting the clam on the pizza. You know, it's accessible. And the one that got it right was Frank Pepe. Other pizzerias were putting it on a red sauce. He said, nope, it should just be olive oil because of the way that the flavors of the kind of salty, briny flavor of the clam mix with, you know, garlic and oregano, you don't need sauce. So that's how that balance happened. And it became extraordinarily popular starting in the 1970s and just took off.
That's wild. Is that now? Is that
it? Is it is
as far as like locals? Is that usually the go-to? I mean, is that the number one pizza there?
So interestingly, locals will have way more opinions than you can even imagine. Like I'm opinionated. The director of the film, Gorm Bouchard, is very opinionated. And if you ask anything from the cab driver to the like the guy standing around on the street, where do you eat pizza? Everybody has an opinion and what their favorite kind is. There is no agreement. And so locals don't necessarily say, oh, I love the white clam. A lot of them never had the white clam. So locals will often tell you, they'll go to their neighborhood pizzeria, you know, and there's pizzerias like Zupardi's Abitz in West Haven. That's super historic, family owned. They make their own sausage pie. There's one that I grew up with called Ernie's Pizzeria, voted sometimes like the best mozzarella because of the layer of mozzarella they put on. And you could just go around the city, and there's just about, there could be more pizzerias per capita in this area than anywhere else. And there's way more opinions. I'll tell you that. There's just, everyone's got an opinion.
Yeah, so question about Zupardi's. You were mentioning sort of the movie you were talking about. How did you make the decision in terms of, like, who the three were going to be? I mean, I imagine you're going to have Zupardi fans very upset.
Well, yeah. I mean, luckily I didn't have to make that decision, so I can just exit the conversation. Yeah. So the director really came up with the concept, over 10 years ago, to have really the three, what we consider, like, we consider the big three. So there's the trinity of the top that we kind of just all bow down to. And then under that, you could almost call them the patron saints. You know, if we're going to stay with this kind of religious connotation. And under that are all the saints that we all still appreciate and carry with us. But in a sense, there's the big three, and then there's everyone else, and how they sit with everybody else. I mean, that's what makes this conversation fun and contentious. And my book is historic. I'm trying to take my opinion out of this entire subject and just give a proper history of the Italian American experience and pizza in New Haven. And then, you know, I think the movie is much more of a we're going to force this down your throat, and you are going to only know about this. But it's more that, honestly, the movie is way more than that. I mean, it's a history of New Haven's redevelopment. It's a history of Italians, and it's a lot more, but it's focused on those three pizzerias. So, you know, I'll leave it at that. You'll have to watch it.
Yeah, I do feel like you had a very privileged life growing up in terms of pizza.
Yes.
I will say, for the longest time, I really thought pizza was, well, it's like you got your Domino's fans and your Pizza Hut fans, and then you kind of just argue it out. And it wasn't until I moved to Minneapolis for college that I had Black Sheep Pizza that I thought, like, wow, that was the best pizza I've had all the time. And it tastes so different. Or, you know, I usually thought, like, okay, if I'm going to have, like, four slices of one of the aforementioned, I'm going to have to take a nap that day. Any productivity is off. And then I had that a different kind of pizza, and I was like, wow, I could have a whole pie and not feel like I was going to die tomorrow. As far as pizza for you that's not New Haven, when you go about, what is your favorite pizza outside of the city?
Well, I like other foods too. I mean, I don't eat pizza outside of New Haven. That's crazy. I learned that
the hard
way.
The best. Okay. Yeah. Tell me about that.
Well, I went to school in New Orleans, Louisiana.
Oh, wow.
So my college days were down in the Big Easy, one of my favorite places to go outside of New Haven. And it's not known for pizza.
Right.
It's known for wonderful Cajun and Creole food, Southern food, you know, and it's just not known for pizza. So I discovered a chain pizza place there that college kids could eat without, you know, fear, I guess. And that particular one, Papa John's, every time you'd get it, it's the same. And it wasn't really pizza for me. It was just junk food. So that feeling that you describe as kind of being KO'd after eating it is kind of how we all felt, is that you'd eat it and then you didn't feel that great.
Yeah.
It filled a void in your stomach, but it didn't do the pizza thing for me. So, you know, I lived in Florida for a little bit. I lived in Maine for like a month. I wrote a book up there on a frozen lake. That's another story. And then I lived in Los Angeles for a bit. And every experience I can tell you is the pizza out there was inconsistent. It was not up to the level that I was used to. And I can understand that. And I also grew up, you know, I ate Domino's growing up. I mean, I tried Pizza Hut once in Pennsylvania. You know, it's a testament to the fact that if you're used to having that kind of pizza and then you try something that's crafted, whether it's New Haven style or not, or any other style, if it's crafted by a family or, you know, some restaurant or some passionate chef that really cares, and it's made fresh with fresher ingredients, I think that your stomach will tell you that you're happy, and your brain will tell your stomach to get more. So there's sort of a connection between you know, what you are, what you eat. So if you're eating better, you will be better. And the junk food, the preservatives in all the sugar, all of the other ingredients that are in those chain kind of run of the mill, you know, pizzerias, it really saturates the market, and they have way more advertising money. And I think much more of America knows pizza from that. It's time to re-educate this country. It's time to try some real pizza.
Yeah. So as far as being in the pizza game, obviously you're part of this documentary. Do you feel like now there's sort of been a resurgence of passion in pizza?
Yeah, I agree, Jake. I think that this is hard to believe, but pizza is only getting more and more passionate for people. It's getting more and more of a, I guess, popular subject that people can weigh in on. It's becoming more accessible to more people. It doesn't seem to be slowing down in any way. I think the numbers prove it too. If you look at, there's plenty of facts on how much pizza gets consumed every year and the money that it generates, and it's increasing. So the subject itself is becoming more interesting. With the world of influencers, you know, this world of like online access to information, there's so much more, you know, pizza professionals now. So you can look at anybody who wants to post a photo and an opinion about pizza, and more people out of any others will like the pizza photos. They just become more attractive. They're more approachable. And we can, you know, right now, a fairly well-known gentleman named Dave Portnoy has been, you know, rocking the pizza world with his Barstool pizza reviews, and people are going insane on watching those and getting reviewed and listening to one man's review of, you know, of his opinion about pizza. But he's considered in a lot of ways a deity of pizza, and people look to those kind of people for their opinions, and they want to know if somebody with that much clout, you know, has an opinion, then they will then follow suit. And it's more than just food. It's clearly bigger than food. Pizza is, it's really become a kind of, you know, an experience that connects us together. It makes us realize that we want to keep going. We want to keep eating. I'm hungry now.
What I love most about those reviews is maybe the next few days after those reviews, seeing how that place's life just changed after that influencer goes, gives a review. And then I think, you know, they'll post or repost photos of days later, like lines out the door.
Absolutely. I mean, this is kind of that it's an experience within an experience. So you offer something, if you do really well, I mean, the power that social media has now to spread word is unfathomable, and people are very responsive to it. We could almost say it's very fragile. You know, if you say the wrong thing, it can cascade and go against a place. And if you don't say anything or you show the right picture, I mean, it can blossom.
Right.
So I think there's a lot of power in this easy world of influence, and it's something that I take very seriously as well, as somebody who's, I'm not an influencer, but I'm, you know, I love these subjects that are popular, and I want to use them for positive results. My goal is to educate. You know, I'm not trying to make or break a business. I'm trying to give people more information. So I think it's fun. I think it's fascinating. You know, I've obviously have a major passion for New Haven style pizza,
right.
And will express my opinions once in a while. But I also don't like to discourage people from, you know, loving what they love, loving what they grew up with, because that's who they are. That's what they know.
Sure.
And there's, you can't tell someone no. You know, that's what they love.
There's a certain, I think there's a certain balance that you want to strike where, you know, the pizza spectrum is very broad, and it's got characters all across it. But, you know, what's the best part of it is, like, you got to be partisan. I mean, you got to, you know, the partisan guys is what allows you, you know, the passion and everything else. You want somebody who loves what they love and is happy to give the hard time to Chicago like they deserve, you know?
Yeah, I mean, John Stewart did a great job years ago, you know, kind of calling it a above ground swimming pool, marinara swimming pool for rats. I it'll always make me laugh, his delivery, you know, just the words. But it's funny, too, because when you talk to Chicagoans and people who grew up there, people who, you know, eat there every day, I mean, it's, you know, millions of people, their pizza of choice is not Chicago style. It's not deep dish. Their pizza choice is going to be a thinner crust pizza. They have other kinds, you know. And there's even a New Haven style pizza place in Chicago that's extraordinarily popular.
Wow.
Called Peace Pizzeria.
Okay.
And people clamor in the Wicker Park area and all over to try what they now realize is New Haven style in Chicago. So, you know, people also make discoveries, and having some contention, having some difference. I mean, what kind of subject would it be without that?
Right, you know, right.
We'd just be talking about flatbread, basically.
And by the way, not for nothing, in that preview, Dave Portnoy said New Haven is the pizza capital of the world. He didn't even qualify it with underdog.
Correct. We now have quotes of him saying not only is the pizza capital of the U.S., he is quoted as saying it's the pizza capital of the world. For whatever that means.
For whatever that
means. It feels good. It feels really good.
It does,
yeah. It feels great.
Yeah.
You know, Old Forge, Pennsylvania has signs outside of that city that claim it's the pizza capital of the world. And the governor of New Jersey just claimed on National Pizza Day that New Jersey is the pizza capital of the world. So you can make up whatever you want. I mean, this is also a world where you can just say whatever you want.
Totally.
And see what gives. But proof is in the pudding. See, that's the ultimate thing. And I think that if people made the pilgrimage to New Haven and they tried what we call one of the big three, and then even tried some of the other ones that are here, because just about any, you know, top rated pizzeria in New Haven is going to be probably mind blowing and extraordinarily different and higher quality than most people are used to. That is the test. That's the real test. And if you are a pizza aficionado, and even if you're not, now you are, then you've got to make the pilgrimage to New Haven. It's also a beautiful city. I mean, it's got Yale University. There's museums. There's a harbor. And there's actually a lot of other really, really good food here. You know, all sorts of ethnic food from the Middle East to South America and Latin America, great French cuisine. And so you can find a ton of different kinds of things happening, but we're known for pizza. Oh, and one other thing, the hamburger sandwich.
The what?
I don't know if you, the hamburger sandwich.
Okay.
Invented by a German immigrant named Louis Lassen in the year 1900. So there's another subject. We can hit that another time.
Oh, let's.
That could be a whole other game right there.
Let's. I think what you did was just promise to be a recurring guest, and we're happy to have you.
Sure. Okay, I'll be there.
Okay, so tell me about how did you get into doing what you're doing? You said you do pizza tours in New Haven. You've written several books, some on ice, some on land. Who are you? How did you get into all this?
Like you, I'm a good listener. So I listened to myself and what I wanted. My background is architecture, and I still design buildings and spaces, and I love that process. I love that. I've always been an artist. Along the way, as a kid, I got into history. I wanted to know what was in my backyard, what was underground, when was my house built, who built it. You know, I had a lot of questions. I was very much a curious person of the land, and I guess I did my own projects and had my own little collections of facts and artifacts and things. So I get, you know, what you might say, it was really just a passion and maybe obsessions. I turned into a careers. And it's interesting to think about things that I try to tell everybody, don't ignore the things that you love or the things that make you happy, because those things could end up becoming what you do all the time.
Right.
And it might be more fulfilling to do those. So, so history writing, I started writing books, 16 years ago on local history, which was one of my passions, and then the food tours actually began on a whim. When I was living in Los Angeles, I needed more money. It's not cheap living by the water anywhere. So, I was doing some side gigs, acting, background acting, whatever. You know, Jerry Springer shows, no big deal.
No bigs.
Yeah, I wasn't a regular on that.
I was going to say, was that real? I mean, you were on Jerry Springer.
I was on a dating show.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if you'll ever see it, but it was really silly. I mean, these were all just fun ways to things you couldn't do back in Connecticut, you know. So I ended up getting a gig doing food tours, and I loved it. And it proved that I had this other passion, which is passion for educating and talking about food. And I certainly know, I've always known I've had a passion for food. I just didn't realize how much. And I think that exposed me to a world of learning about what we eat, where it comes from, what's healthy, what's, you know, what cultures have created it, and how is it served. So I brought that idea back to New Haven, and about 10 years ago started Taste of New Haven, first tried and true tour company in the state. And we've expanded, you know, over the years, and we now run classes, festivals. We teach and tour every age group. From literally, I do pizza tours for kindergartners.
That's awesome.
How fun would that be? Yeah, and I'm bringing my Wesleyan University college class to on a walking tour on Sunday. We're going to be eating pizza. So I mean, you know, the idea is to like take things you love, and then I'm trying to teach them and give people ideas about the world we live in and the places we live in, and try to find their passion in that. They might not think the way I think, but at least they can glean something off of it. And I think that's what I've begun to realize that I enjoy the most is really giving people a chance to learn and experience on their own.
So I was asking you about it before, but tell us about your Wesleyan gig.
Yeah. That was a whim. So I was teaching a high school group. I was like lecturing a high school group, and one of the parents of one of the children came to me and said, I love what you're doing. This is amazing. You've got all these books. You want to be on my radio show? Oh no, that was you. and
yeah.
So anyway, the parent said, you know, you sounds like you have enough body of knowledge to teach. Would you like to, you know, propose some courses? And I ended up putting a few syllabi together, and the school liked it and offered me a teaching position, which I've started. So the idea is, I think you can, you know, I didn't realize I could just become a professor, but now I am.
But now it's you are.
yeah, it's too late. I my eyebrows are growing faster. I'm just finding old jackets.
I was gonna say, I bet your blazer game is tip top.
Yeah, yeah. Well, luckily, my grandfather left me all of his 1960s blazers.
Oh man,
like plaid, pink,
yes.
Corduroy. So I'm just gonna wear all of them, and they'll have to accept what I say is true. No, but generally speaking, getting to college students is great. I think these are students that are so in the college world, especially liberal arts. A lot of people are rounded, but they're not focused. So my course is extraordinarily focused. I mean, I'm literally saturating my class with like history of like the Winchester Repeating Arms Company, and they're going to learn everything about the Winchester family. And they're scared. I mean,
they're
scared. This is a gun company. Yeah. There's the Winchester Mystery House in San Jose, California, where, you know, the sins of the Winchester rifle are exposed, and, you know, staircases that lead nowhere. So all these ideas are fun and interesting, but the idea too is to connect people to, you know, to real subjects.
Sure.
And make people feel like it's tangible. You know, you can actually look out your back window and tell stories and learn.
Not only are you a professor, but you're a professor who strikes fear, which I think is a level up.
Yeah, well, I got to grade these kids, so I need them to do something. I mean, geez, yeah, I try.
Awesome, man. New Haven, Connecticut, food tours.
Taste of New Haven, yep.
Okay, so if folks, after listening to this, are so possessed that they just immediately buy a plane ticket, what do they do? if they come to New Haven? They go to your website, they sign up?
Well, first off, our airport is beautifully small. There's only two planes that come in from either Philadelphia or Charlotte. but you can connect. So anyway, that's a joke. It's true. Our airport is very small, but you can get here. What I would suggest is before you make the flight, before you make the drive or take your yacht, is check out the website, tasteofnewhaven.com. Create a trip out of it, plan something, because you could sign up for a food tour, which are mostly on the weekends.
Okay.
And then I would also suggest that if you're coming in warm weather, really explore this area. Check out, some of the natural areas in Connecticut. We have one of the best, actually the largest and highest rated Native American museum in the whole country.
Oh, wow.
Is at Foxwoods. It's the Mashantucket Pequot Museum. It's unbelievable experience. And then you got the casinos, and then you've got just an amazing state of like, it's a beautiful, kind of wooded and coastal state of adventure. So I would make a whole trip out of it. And then you could visit the small cities like New York and Boston,
right? If you have time.
Yeah, if you're going to come to New Haven, there's hotels, it's a walkable city. You can easily do a food tour and then explore some other spots. We have free art museums. There's an amazing there's the Knights of Columbus Museum is here. That's an amazing museum of Catholic history.
Crazy.
The Knights of Columbus is headquartered in New Haven and started in New Haven. So, a ton of history here and a lot to explore.
All right. So be sober-minded about this trip. Look at what all you can do. Tell us the name of the movie again.
It's called Pizza, A Love Story.
Got it. And we can just either plan for it in our trips there or wait patiently for something like Hulu or Amazon.
Yeah. It's going to hit some sort of physical form later this year.
Okay, great.
The other thing is if you do go to the website and you can reach out to the director, Gorman, and just say, I want to see the movie, help. And if enough people do that, he'll say, why are all these people telling me they heard you on the radio, Colin, and that now they're demanding it? And I want to hear him say that.
Okay, well, there it is. We'll do it.
I'm trying to pull my weight.
Excellent. We'll do it. We'll absolutely do it. And Colin, do you want to tell us a couple of your books? We can get them on Amazon, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So Pizza in New Haven is the latest. It's on the history of pizza coming to the East Coast, particularly in the city of New Haven, an area. So you can find that on Amazon, Pizza in New Haven. Some other books mostly focused on Connecticut, but one of a fun one is Legendary Locals of New Haven. And it talks about a lot of different people.
Okay.
Those are a couple I would suggest.
Awesome, man. And I got to tell you, my favorite pages in Pizza in New Haven was the crust pictures.
Is it the slices?
The crust pictures.
Yeah, I was going to say the slices. Yeah. Yep.
Those are awesome, man. That's awesome. I love it. Yep. Do people tell you that all the time?
Well, a lot of people who eventually read to that section, it's like later in the book.
Yep.
I want to thank my wife, April, and my best friend, Dan, and his dad, who staged and created those photos, because they're all photographers, and getting that level of detail is just, it's so important. And I was actually influenced by the creators of modernist cuisine, and who are creating a book called Modernist Pizza they're out of the Seattle area. And the head guy is Nathan Mirvold. A very, very smart, talented guy. And I was fortunate enough to connect with him and his book, Modernist Bread. And that level of detail, it was inspiring. So I had a lot of help. That page couldn't have existed without all those people helping.
It looks like it, man. It's definitely an excellent picture. Definitely, if that doesn't make you want to book that flight, I don't know what will. So everybody, go find those books. Colin, thank you so much for offering your time, man. We really appreciate it.
Oh, thanks, Jake. I appreciate being part of your show.
Awesome, man. Well, like I said, don't be surprised when we hit you up for the burger sandwich.
I'll do my homework.
All right, man. Thank you so much.
I'll get that story ready.
Take care.
You're welcome, Jake. All the best.